Welcome to another week online with us. In a time when everything feels out of control, we want to be a place where you can find hope. We love you and want to remind you that even though we're not meeting in person, we are still here for you. Reach out anytime to the number on the screen if you need to talk or pray with someone. This week, we're kicking off XO, a new dating series, where we will be diving into what biblical singleness and dating look like. Each week, we will provide a space to worship, learn from God's word, and dive into application in our groups. With this series, we are offering a special breakdown of additional questions you may have each week by continuing the conversation on Instagram Live at 8:30 every Wednesday night. So make sure you're following at HS Elevate on Instagram, submitting your questions, and having those notifications turned on. We are so excited to jump into this brand new series with you now.
Well, hey, Elevate, welcome tonight from wherever you're watching. We're so excited to be with you for Elevate Online. We're going to sing about the freedom that we have in Jesus. So come on, sing with us.
Step out of the shadows, step out of the grave, break into the wild. And don't be afraid. Run into wide open spaces. Grace is waiting for you. Dance like the weight has been lifted. Grace is waiting.
Come on.
Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is freedom. Where the Spirit scars. Come back to communion. Come back to the star. Run into wide open spaces. Grace is waiting for you. Dance like the weight has been lifted. Grace is waiting. Where the Spirit Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Come out of the dark, just as you are, into the fullness of His love. For the Spirit is here, let there be freedom, let there be freedom. Chains will fall, prisons shake at the sound of Jesus' name. Lives made whole, hearts awake at the sound of Jesus' name. Chains will fall, prisons shake at the sound of Jesus' name. Lives made whole, hearts awake at the sound of Jesus' name. Freedom, there is freedom. Come out of
Go to that bridge. If the stars were made to worship, sing that.
If the stars were made to worship, so will I. If the mountains bow in reverence, so will I. If the oceans roar your greatness, so will I. So will I. If the rocks cry out in silence, so will I. If the sum of all our praises still falls shy, then we'll sing. Designed in a work of our core love.
All right, guys, we are together again. We are going to get started with a new series tonight where we're talking on dating. We're calling this series XO. And so we're just excited to kind of see what the Lord has for us. We know that dating is a season of life that is particularly difficult, that this is kind of a tough time for us. I remember when I realized that dating was tough, it went all the way back in kindergarten. I had a little girlfriend in kindergarten and we were tight. She used to sit beside me during story time. So that's how you know that it's real. But in my class, there was also a young boy who was quite smitten with this girl. And so he comes up to me and says, Matthew, you know, let's have a football game for this girl. And I thought, yeah, that sounds like a good idea because I was in kindergarten. And I'm not really sure about how that worked because it wasn't like a one-on-one game of football. So I don't know how that exactly worked. But I am confident of the fact that I won because it blew up in my face. And so this young boy became a little bit of a sore loser, and he went to the girl and he told her what had happened. He told her that now we had to get married, and that's a scary thing for a five-year-old to hear, I'm told. And so he went to her, he told her all this. She comes to me during story time again and says, hey, so we're getting married. And that was the end of that relationship. I think I also went home sick that day. So relationships, tough, right? And so as we kind of talk through this, there's some reasons why we want to talk through relationships. We're seeing that this is something that we continually kind of mess up with. And so we want to talk about relationships because we know it's on your mind. We know that a lot of you guys are kind of thinking about a relationship in the future, or you're in a relationship, and some of you, you're not quite there yet. We get that. That's okay. Hopefully this is a little bit of a framework for you to work for in the future. We also want to talk about this today because we see some of you getting hurt. We see that this is kind of like a fire that nobody's really ever told you how to handle. And because it is so dangerous and it's so confusing for some of us, we're getting hurt with this thing. And so we want to talk about it because we're getting hurt. Not only that, but we see you accidentally or intentionally hurting other people with relationships. And so we want to talk through this because it is like a fire. And as you kind of play with this fire, as you don't know what you're doing, with this fire, people around you are going to get hurt. And it's hard to share the love of Christ with somebody that you have hurt. And so we want to talk about it for that reason. And lastly, we want to talk about relationships today because I wholeheartedly believe that there is a better way to handle this thing, that there is something that God wants us to do in this season where he allows us to become the person that we're called to be and become the people who are able to love each other well. And so I'm not going to speak today as an expert on dating. That's not who I am. I have tons of mistakes in my dating past, right? But I want to talk to you as an older brother, as somebody who's walked through these waters and has some scars, has some experiences, and maybe is able to help you find a way that this goes a little bit better. And so as we get started, I want to kind of lay out some goals for you as we kind of tackle this topic, right? The first thing that I would say today is that my goal is to give you a little bit better of a filter for how to walk through this season. We just kind of talked about this is something that we don't know what to do with. This is something that is kind of out of control that we don't have a framework for. And so what we want to do with this series is kind of give you a little bit of a filter to walk through. We also want to get rid of some idolatry that might be surrounding our dating relationships. Scripture's clear. In the Bible, anything that comes before God, anything that preoccupies our hearts, anything that we set our minds on is an idol. And we see that that might be something that is happening a little bit with relationships. And Jesus is going to speak directly into this in Matthew 6, and he's going to talk about some idols that rise up in our minds and kind of take the place of him. And what he's going to kind of say there is he's going to say, hey, seek first the kingdom of God. Seek first my will. Seek first me, and I'll take care of all the gifts that you need. I'm the giver of gifts. Put me first, and I will be able to help you through all this. And I believe that that's something that we kind of mess up with dating, that somehow we allow dating to become the goal. We become, our identity is found in dating. And we want to kind of lower that down and seek God first. Give him back the throne of our hearts, right? And then lastly, I get a lot of flack sometimes for kind of being anti-dating. I was with a lot of you guys in middle school. And during that season of time, whenever we talked about dating, I would kind of make this phrase of, I'd say no dating till after you're married. I'd kind of say, don't do that until after you're married. Obviously I was joking in that point. But now I realize that we're getting to the point where some of you guys can handle this responsibly. And so my goal is that you would find the person that you're supposed to be with, that you would become the person that God is calling you to be. And so we're going to talk about this. And as we walk through this, the first thing that I want to kind of tackle tonight is I want to talk about the season before dating. I want to talk about the season that comes for everyone before dating, and that is the season of singleness. And as I kind of say that, I know that there's some labels that our culture kind of puts on singleness, that it's almost embarrassing, it's almost shameful to be in the season of singleness. And I know for some of you, as we talk about singleness, it brings up feelings of loneliness, right? Like you kind of look around and you see people who are together, you see people in the hallways, you see your friends, and they have relationships, and you kind of think, man, I would like that. I feel a little lonely in this moment. Some of you guys might feel, as we talk about singleness, you're kind of embarrassed, that there's kind of some uncomfortability. As you look at other people, you kind of ask the question, man, what's wrong with me? Like, is there something wrong with me? Why is this kind of happening this way? And some of you, as you think about singleness, it brings up feelings, emotions of inadequacy or maybe rejection. Maybe for you, you are not single for lack of trying, right? Like you keep shooting your shot and you keep getting out there and you just keep getting rejected, that people aren't picking up what you're putting down, right? That's kind of what's going on in this season. I just kind of want to stop and say, as we get started here, that singleness, that this season that you're walking through is nothing to be embarrassed about, that this is a season that God has designed for you. In fact, the author Paul in the New Testament will say that I wish everyone was single like me. We kind of learned that there that he is single. And we learned that the reason why he wishes everyone was single like him is because there is a gift in singleness, that God is trying to teach people something in singleness. And so it's not embarrassing to be single. It is embarrassing to waste that season. And so what we want to do tonight is we want to talk about what are the lessons that God is trying to teach us in this season, and how do we walk forward in them. And so if you have your Bibles, go ahead and flip with me over to Genesis chapter 2. Genesis chapter 2, verse 18, that's where we're going to kind of park today. Genesis is really showing us kind of the beginning of time and how God has kind of set up relationships. And so we're going to see a lot of what God's original intention was, what God's design for our life is, and kind of learn what he's trying to teach this guy Adam in this passage. So Genesis 2, 18, it says, "Then the Lord God said, 'It is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper who is just right for him.'" So God in this passage is looking at Adam, and he looks and sees Adam in the garden. Now God has already set up Adam. He's in the middle of this Garden of Eden, and he's kind of placed him as the governor of the garden. And as we kind of see this unfold, what happens is God kind of puts him here with animals, with trees, with all these things around him. And he says, hey, I want you to be my representative in this place. But God looks and sees Adam, and he recognizes that something's not quite right in his relationship, that he needs someone, that he is alone in this season. And Adam is able to kind of look around and see, man, there's giraffes over there. They have somebody. There's elephants over there. They have somebody. There's monkeys over there. They have somebody. But I am alone. And so God makes this promise in this passage. I will make a helper who is just right for him. I will make a helper who is just right for him. So you expect verse 19 to kind of be, and God made woman, God made Eve. But that's not what we see in verse 19. What we see is something completely different. It says verse 19, so the Lord God formed from the ground all the wild animals and all the birds of the sky. He brought them to the man to see what they would call them, and the man chose a name for each one. He gave names to all the livestock, all the birds of the sky, and all the wild animals. But still, there was no helper just right for him. So what we should see here is God fulfilling the promise. Hey, I'm going to make Adam a helper. But what we see instead is we see God give Adam a job to do. We see him do something completely different. This is kind of the situation as Adam realizes that he's lonely. He gets a giraffe brought to him and he names the giraffe. He gets an elephant brought to him and he names the elephant. And you got to think that at some point, Adam kind of goes to God and he says, hey, look, I love doing this job that you've given me. I love what I have to do, but I don't want to name animals anymore. I want a girl. Like I want somebody for me. And what we see in this passage is that sometimes God allows there to be a little bit of a gap between his promise and his provision. There's a gap between his promise and his provision. And that's what we see. The reason why this is here is because Adam has some things that he needs to learn in his singleness. There's some things that he needs to learn in his singleness. Now, I want to stop right here. This passage right here is not a promise that everybody is going to have a soulmate, that this is not, you know, God saying, hey, I'm going to make sure everybody is not lonely. I know lots of godly people who end up being single for a long season in their life, or maybe even their whole life. That's not what God is doing here. God hasn't failed them, but what he is doing is saying, hey, in the midst of your need, in the midst of you wanting someone, I'm going to be able to provide for you. I can keep my promises. And so we see this idea that there's a time between his promise and his provision all over scripture. We've just been studying a little bit of Abraham on Sunday mornings. If you've been listening with Pastor Tim, there's a gap between kind of this promise and provision in Abraham's life, right? God comes to Abraham as a 75-year-old man and says, hey, Abraham, you're going to have a child. I'm going to make you the father of many nations. I'm going to make you the father of nations. And Abraham says, hey, problem, I'm 75. Like, that doesn't work right, right? And God says, I've got you. And yet there's still a 25-year gap between God giving that promise and the provision of the promise. Abraham has this kid as a 100-year-old man, right? We also see it in the life of David, right? Samuel comes to David and says, David, you're going to be the next king. You're going to be the king over all of Israel. He comes and tells him this as a young boy. And yet he's 30 before he ever sets foot in the palace. And so we see this happen all over scripture where there is a gap between the promise and the provision. There's a reason for that. There's a reason why God allows that to happen, not just in singleness, but in your life. The reason why he does that is because God is a God who works in the waiting, that he works in the midst of this time. And so some things specifically that he works on in your singleness is he does this. Singleness is a time where you can get right with God. The reason why God allows this time of singleness is because he wants you to work on a relationship between him and you. In fact, 1 John 4:19 will say it this way, we are able to love because he first loved us. In other words, we're not able to love someone else until we recognize that God has loved us. And I know that some of you guys will kind of throw a flag here and say, what about me and my boyfriend? Like, we don't even go to church and we love each other or whatever. Well, I would ask the question, how much does that love look like Jesus's love? How sacrificial is that love? How willing are you to lay down your life for that person? Because that's the way that Jesus loves. And so what we learn from this passage in scripture is that we're not able to have right relationship with somebody else until we get right relationship with God. We're not able to operate correctly until we get right with God. So the question arises, what does it look like to get right with God? What is going on in the Garden of Eden between Adam and God? What does right relationship look like? Well, I think the first thing that God kind of teaches Adam in the garden is that he is for you. He is for Adam. Like, he is there for Adam. God is for you. And kind of how this plays out is God is meant to be Adam's kind of provider. That whenever Adam needs anything, when he's hot, when he's cold, when he needs anything, he goes directly to God. There's nobody else for him to go to. He goes to God. And this is what our relationship with God should look like. This is what right relationship with God looks like, that he is our provider, that he's our first call, that ultimately, you know, our mom is not there to provide for us. Our girlfriend is not there to provide for us, that God is meant to be for us. He is there for us. But the other side of that coin, the other side of right relationship with God, is that you are for God. You are for God. In other words, whenever we see creation happen, God looks at the trees. He says, those are good. He looks at the water, made that, that's good. Looks at the animals, made that, that's good. But he looks at man and says, hey, I'm gonna make man a little bit different. I'm gonna make them in my image. And whenever he creates Adam, he looks at him and says, you're not just good, you're very good. Like, this is very good. And what he's doing in that moment is he's setting Adam up as kind of governor of the garden. He sets him up as kind of the ruler of the land in his place, that God has allowed Adam to kind of be his representative here on earth. That's what God looks to us to do, that we are created in his image so that we would shine his image into the world, that we would show everyone what we're supposed to be. And so as we embrace that identity, as we embrace the image of God, what happens is God is able to affirm us. He's able to give us acceptance. That's who we're supposed to be. We're supposed to live our life first and foremost for God, for God. And so when we get this relationship wrong, this is where a lot of the issues in dating relationships come from. When we don't understand right relationship with God, this is where a lot of things get messed up. Because what's going to happen is you're going to start to take on the identity of you are for him or her. You're gonna start looking at him or her to give you the things that only God can give you. And so you're gonna start looking to her and asking, man, do I please you? Like, do I make you happy? Like, who do I need to be in order to make you happy? And so what happens in relationships is you start changing yourself because you don't know who you are in front of God, because you don't know who God is calling you to be. And so you start changing yourself to be whatever makes that girl or that guy happy. You put way too much pressure on a 17-year-old to give you what only God can give you. And so that's the first thing that we see kind of mess up whenever we don't have right relationship with God. The other thing that we see mess up when we don't have right relationship with God is we start thinking that other people are for us. That the way that God is meant to be there for us, other people are for us. Somebody who is made in the image of God, we start looking at like they're there to please us. That this is where you kind of see the kind of consumer mentality when it comes to people. That ultimately the people that we come into contact with are there solely to provide for us. And this is where we see all these accidents happen in relationships. All these mess ups happen in relationship. When we start looking at a girl or a guy, like they are there to make us happy. That they are there to please us. This is where we see issues like pornography. This is where we see issues like abuse. This is where we see issues like sex before marriage. This is where this all comes from, this idea that they are here to please us. Instead of being someone who is made in the image of God, we see somebody who is there to please us. And so we use them however we want to. And so this is why it's so important that in the season of singleness that you're in, you learn what right relationship with God looks like, that you learn who you are before God. Second thing that we learn in singleness that we can see in this passage is that singleness is a time where you can figure out your purpose, where you can figure out your purpose. You see, Adam had a unique calling. It was to name all of the animals in the garden. That was his calling. That's why he was here on this earth. Like he was there to do that. If Adam didn't do that, then it wouldn't have been done. Like it would not have been done. And so Adam was there for that specific reason. See, I believe that each one of you has a specific purpose, a specific calling on your life. You have a reason why you're here. You have something that you're supposed to accomplish. It's not just come to church and read your Bible and be a good son. Like that's not your purpose. Your purpose is so much more than that. I believe that there are people watching today who need to make discoveries in the scientific community, that you have something that you were designed to discover, right? I believe that there are people listening today who were meant to be some fifth grade teacher, that you help influence the lives of students. I believe that there are people listening today who's meant to teach the word of God. I believe that with all of my heart, that you have a designed purpose. Like God doesn't make people by accident. You have something that you are called to do, right? But the only way that you figure out that calling, the only way that you step into who God is calling you to be is if you sit for long amounts of time in front of God saying, "What is it, God? What's my calling? What am I here for?" That you ask the questions, man, what am I passionate about? What has God put on my heart? How has God gifted me? And how does that line up with God's heart? How do I make whatever I'm good at, make whatever I'm passionate about line up with God's heart? See, that only happens when you have lots of time to spend alone with you and Jesus. That's the only way that happens, right? And I just wanna let you in on a little secret about relationships. Relationships also take lots of time. Like you find yourself doing things, you find yourself vacuuming out your car before every date, you find yourself buying flowers, you find yourself, you know, it takes lots of time to be in a relationship. And I'm not saying relationships are bad, relationships are great, but I am saying that it is so much more important that you find your calling before you find that relationship, because once you get into that relationship, it's going to be hard to do the hard work of being in a relationship and finding your calling. And another thing about that too, is that once you find, if you're not set on your calling, if you don't know exactly what that is, it's very easy for a relationship to kind of skew your calling. That all of a sudden it kind of consumes your calling. We see this happen all the time, right? It's very clear that somebody is meant to go to Nashville for school after high school, and yet some girl gets an offer to some school up in Bristol, and all of a sudden the guy starts looking at schools in Bristol. What do you know, right? We see all the time that relationships, if we're not careful, can conform our calling, that we can mess up our calling because we are not certain in it. And so singleness is meant to be the season where you know your calling, where you know what your purpose is before God, where you spend time alone before Him and figure out, why am I here on earth? What am I here to do? And so tonight, as we kind of wind down, I wanna make sure that this isn't just something that we put off to the side, that this is something that we can kind of respond to, right? And so as we talk, I believe that there are two groups that are kind of listening to this, right? We have people who are single, We have people who are hearing this and you hear, man, it's not embarrassing that I'm single. Like singleness is meant for a reason, that it's there for a purpose, right? And I'm so glad that you're hearing that. I don't want anybody to ever be embarrassed of the stage of life that God has put you in. But it is embarrassing, hear me on this, it is embarrassing if you waste that time. Like it's embarrassing if you don't use that season to learn the lessons that God is trying to teach you. And so I want you to do some work while you're in this season. I want you to make the most of this season by figuring out right relationship with God, by figuring out that He is for you and you are for Him. Do some work in learning that and digging that deep into your heart so that you're ready when the next season comes. I also want you to do the work of finding out what your purpose is. Take this time to sit down and say, what am I passionate about? Where am I gifted? Where does that line up with the heart of God? Make sure that you do not waste this season of singleness. I think there's also some people watching this who you are in a relationship, and that's awesome. Listen, I don't want to ever say that's bad. That's awesome. I'm so for that. I believe that that is a stage that God calls each of us to at some point in our lives. And so as we get there, what I do want to say is I want to make sure that you're ready for that season. I want to make sure that you are ready for that season because we see so much pain for people getting into a season that they're not ready for. And so as you kind of listen tonight, I want you to think about what is right relationship with God look like for you. I want you to do the work of saying, man, do I have this relationship right between me and God? Are we right? Do I know that He is for me? She's not for me. He is for me. And do I know that I am for Him? I am meant to glorify Him with my life. And do you know what your calling is? Do you know what God is calling you to? Now, I'm not saying you need to have your whole life mapped out, but I am saying that there is a special wiring in you and you need to learn what that is before you get into that relationship. Look, guys, like I said, I'm not against dating. I'm so for it, but I want to make sure that it is a good thing in our lives. I believe that relationships can be a good thing in our lives, but I don't want us to miss out on a God thing because we're so busy searching for good things. And so as we kind of close, I want us to do a little bit of reflection. I want us to evaluate a little bit, and we'll be able to talk about this more in our groups. Let me pray. Father God, we thank you for who you are. We thank you that you are a God who's over relationships, that ultimately relationships, marriage are your design, Lord God, but also singleness is your design, Lord. And so I pray that as we walk through this season of our life, Lord God, that we would make the most of this season, that we would learn the lessons that we're called to learn so that we would glorify you more. We love you. We ask you this in your name. Amen.